Hello, I'm Brooke Doyle, and I'm very glad to have some time here with you today to talk about some work OCLC Research has done studying the challenges and opportunities brought on by the COVID-19 pandemic. We were really interested in how a group of library leaders from around the world were responding to the pandemic and what new library models might emerge from this time of social and economic change. What we mean by library model is the essence of what libraries are and how they function. I hope as I share our learnings from across this wide group of libraries, it will prompt you to think about how this resonates with your experience of the pandemic and will perhaps give you ideas or inspiration as you imagine the future of your library. I will facilitate a conversation at the end where you can share your experiences and your vision for the future. We have a learner guide for you that I want to really encourage you to look at afterwards, where it can help you dig into these findings and think about how they apply to your situation and help you envision the future. Many of the societal changes we've all experienced during the pandemic, while dramatic, have roots in earlier technological advances, generational shifts, and educational movements. The COVID pandemic is a singular shared experience, not just for libraries, but for all individuals and organizations. It accelerated some changes that had already begun, paused others, and birthed even more. We wanted to learn about those transformations. From April to July of 2020, we interviewed 29 library leaders with representation from libraries around the world. We had 17 interviewees were at institutions in North America, 8 in Europe, 1 in the United Arab Emirates, and 3 in the Asia-Pacific region. Among the 29 library leaders, 7 or 24% were from public libraries and 1 from a national library. We included leaders from urban, suburban, and rural areas. Even though these library leaders were at different stages of the pandemic during our discussions, and their responses were varied upon their local context, patterns did emerge. There were commonalities in the responses from academic and public libraries. The specifics of their experiences differed, of course, but the direction and intensity of many of the changes they were making were similar. Drawing from these experiences, the leaders provided insight into their future plans. Our briefing, which you can find at that website on the slide, describes how they are strategically adapting to meet evolving needs and expectations among their staff and communities. We describe these transformations as movements towards their new model library. Throughout the pandemic, library leaders quickly recreated work environments, reassessed collection priorities, and reimagined community engagement activities. We refer to these three emerging themes as the work experiences, the collections experiences, and the engagement experiences. The transformation of these three experiences towards a new model library requires that libraries act with agility, taking that quick and innovative action in response to changing circumstances and expectations. Navigating these changes also requires collaboration, working with stakeholders to lead change within libraries, institutions, and communities. A major part of moving towards a new model library is finding the balance between space, new ways of engaging within that physical library, and then virtualization, expanding online library experiences for staff and the community. I will highlight our major findings in each of these experiences, and I'll begin with the work experiences. When we think about the work experiences, the new model library will emphasize training for the future, focus on staff's well-being, challenge traditional divisions of labor, and embrace work flexibility. Training for the future. Formal and informal learning skyrocketed during the pandemic as staff adapted to new work environments and service delivery models. It highlighted limitations of some of our traditional siloed models of organization. New library models will include staff with versatile skill sets who cross-train, allowing them to move with agility between different tasks as the situation demands. Focus on staff well-being. The shared experience of stress and uncertainty of the pandemic emphasized the need to make sure the work experience was supportive for all staff. Within new library models, we will see places where social connections and staff well-being are valued. Frequent, clear, and compassionate communication and transparency around decision-making will be the norm. Challenge traditional divisions of labor. The pandemic forced people out of their typical work roles. Some had to move across departments to support overloaded areas. Some had to go outside the library and assist at food banks. These temporary changes pushed library leaders to consider long-term structural changes to balance staff workloads, expand or modify services, and improve efficiency. The new library models will consider staff expertise, the library's mission, and the needs of the community when redesigning staff responsibilities and organizational structures. embrace work flexibility. As remote work became the norm for many during the pandemic, that transition was not always seamless. Despite this, library staff continue to meet community needs. New library models will offer flexible options, new library models will offer flexible options for how, where, and when staff work. Common examples include flex time, remote work, compressed work weeks, and family support programs. The new model library will have equitable work policies and practices that respond to staff's varying needs, preferences, and circumstances. I want to just take a minute for you listening to just pause for a second and think about these four areas and which will be a priority for you as you think about the future of your library. And now I'm going to dig into it, share a few quotes that will just kind of make the findings a little richer and come alive a little bit, just a few samples for each experience so you can hear from our interviewees and their words. This leader of an urban public library in Canada emphasized the need for training to help staff navigate change. And I'll read this quote. "We have a curriculum for our librarians and continuing education for longer-term librarians to keep our staff trained and upskilled because we are operating in a massively changing environment." While this is an example of a more formal institutional approach, training might also take the form of peer-to-peer learning with colleagues, discussion groups, online courses, and cross-discipline exchange. Leaders told us about how much learning was taking place, almost a frenzy at the beginning. People were quickly learning new job functions and adapting to new requirements of our changed work environment. The new model library will think about how to train for the future, not just the present. The risk, uncertainty, and change of the pandemic impacted staff's mental, physical, and emotional well-being, and it continues to. I love how this quote encourages us to be gracious and generous in dealing with ourselves and each other. New library models will need to grapple with what it means to support well-being in the work environment and will need to align organizational culture, policies, and activities to support well-being. We're going to shift to the collections experiences. The new model library will focus on these three areas: prioritize resources that close the digital divide, acquire digital and open content strategically, and create new connections to the print collection. Prioritize resources that close the digital divide. I know I've attended a lot of sessions at the conference about the digital divide. This is clearly a huge priority moving forward. It will be essential to provide circulating options for connectivity, software, and devices that enable the community to participate fully in digital life. Acquire digital and open content strategically. The pandemic experience convinced many library staff and users of the value of e-resources, but it also revealed how far there was to go in really achieving their potential. Acquiring digital and open content strategically involves a number of factors. One of the most consistent things we heard from library leaders was the budget challenges posed by e-resources. Leaders spoke about the need to negotiate more strongly with publishers and to invest in open content. Create new connections to the print collections. Physical materials are not going away. They continue to be an essential and in-demand part of library services. What is changing is how library staff think about the circulation of these materials. Increasingly, the discovery and access of physical materials will happen in ways that are mediated by technology and by library staff to improve access, convenience, and enjoyment. So just take a moment and think about which of these will be a priority for you as you look to the future of your library. Is it closing the digital divide, making new connections to physical collections, or digital and open content? I'll share a couple quotes here. Of course, despite increased use of digital resources, online services, and virtual programming, leaders strongly emphasize the need, the role the library played for digital access for their communities. The surge in demand for digital materials called even more attention to the digital divide. This quote really emphasizes that both and, we need the physical space to feel that sense of community, and we need the virtual access, both as a utility and as a convenience. Sometimes the library is people's only access point for both of those things. One major drawback we heard from leaders was that users were not able to browse shelves to select materials. Some users found browsing to be a really important part of their information-seeking process, or they simply preferred it, and others didn't have access or skills to use the library website. We heard about some libraries setting up a reader's advisory service where users would call the library, answer a few questions about their interests, and a librarian would choose several items for them to pick up. It was a delightful experience, as this librarian describes. Oh, I've just got such good things for you, as she was gathering the materials and looking forward to the time they would be handed over. It also opened up further conversations about a patron's interests, and this was a new way to engage with the collection and with the community. I'm going to shift to our last experience, the engagement experience. Based on our interviews, when we think about the engagement experiences in libraries, the New Model Library will focus on inviting engagement in physical space, leading with a hybrid approach, and purposeful partnering. Inviting engagement in physical spaces. Even though online activity was consistent and available during the pandemic, leaders and staff were constantly asked when the physical library would reopen. People needed to engage in person or just be in the physical space. People needed access to Wi-Fi and databases they typically used in library buildings, and they wanted those resources in person. Public library leaders worried about the loss of safe and welcoming spaces, particularly for vulnerable populations who need shelter, like the quote I just read. The New Model Library will invite engagement in the physical space, treating space as a service. Leading with a hybrid approach. The New Model Library will think strategically about what content, virtual delivery, and timing best meet the needs of those who are left out of any in-person offerings, and ensure that community members who need it have the technology to truly benefit from online offerings. New library models will use virtual experiences to maximize staff time and expertise. Partner with a purpose. New Model Libraries will partner purposefully, ensuring that they're adding value in ways that are mutually beneficial to themselves, their partners, and the communities they support. This can mean partnering with those who have complementary expertise and resources to create an integrated response to community needs. This could also mean seeking partners in different locations where the library can work alongside, perhaps areas where the community is less engaged with the library and they can listen and learn about why. Take a moment and think about what will be the biggest priority for you as you think about your future engagement experiences. Is it partnerships? Is it the hybrid approach? Or is it engagement in the physical space? I think this quote really demonstrates that purposeful partnering. The library listened to its users who were telling them that the library felt like a much less stigmatizing place. I quote, "I don't have to walk into a place that says it's a food bank. I'm walking into a library to get my food." So they found a way to partner with the food bank to use the library space as a distribution area. That strategic partnering furthered both organizations' missions. It was a wonderful discovery that the pandemic produced. A suburban public library leader in the Netherlands describes transforming the physical library into a place to be, to study, to come together, to discuss. The pandemic reaffirmed the value of the library's physical spaces. Building closures highlighted the importance of treating library spaces as a service that support people coming together to use the library for different purposes. Leaders plan to find new ways to engage within the library's physical presence and redouble efforts to make spaces more welcoming for all to gather, finding the right balance between robust library online offerings and a vibrant physical space. I've shared some of the changes that library leaders are taking into the future, but they shouldn't be taken as absolutes. There are no universal right answers. We expect each library to choose what to pursue based on their local context. With the uncertainty of budgets, staffing, social and economic changes, we expect the changes to continue. This is why we plan to continue to contextualize the visions of the New Model Library by offering a few more options. I really want to draw your attention to the Learner Guide, which you can find on this webpage. It's a great way to dig into the briefing, dig into the findings that I've shared with you today, and apply them to your situation. There's a lot of really good guiding questions, some reflection activities to do in advance, and then ideally to gather with your staff to really compare answers, think about what things you want to hold on to that were those sort of surprise wins from the pandemic and things you wouldn't have just maybe discovered otherwise, some changes you were forced to make that felt really good, and then the things that you're still stuck on that you're not quite sure how to move forward, how to find the future path. Of course, I want to draw your attention to the briefing, which is the last link on the slide here, to really dig into the findings yourself. I've just kind of scratched the surface. We will continue to have focus group interviews because we feel like this process will continue to evolve as we continue to live in a very changing world. So we hope to get more voices at the table to learn from you and what you're hearing and experiencing and find those common threads. Thank you so much for your time. I appreciate you listening, and I hope you can dig in and find our resources helpful as you imagine your new model library.